It's my pleasure to come again to the University of Michigan to give a lecture. When I met Professor Joseph Lam and in September, we talked about establishing a website and a database on the website that collects all the ancient scores, music notations, as an entire collection for access for research purposes. And Professor Joseph Lam promptly decided that we should do a lecture on the archive, the website, and the database. So, in terms of historical sources, the situations in the West and the East are very different. In the East, a lot of ancient scores are owned privately instead of stored, preserved in museums. So.
所以这个对我们，尤其是近代，就是二十世纪进入二十世纪以后，对古代音乐的研究带来很大的障碍。So
this is a huge hurdle for researchers to study historical music.
我在八十年代到日本去留学，在那里待了十年，拿了一个博士学位，然后就收集了大量的古代。So
I studied in the 80s in Japan and got a PhD there. And studying a lot of ancient scores and music notations.
所以呢，就是大概将近二三十年，甚至很多就是原始的中国留在海外的一些，所以呢，把这些又集中起来，在中国。今年，总算就是把它建立成一个就是古朴的一个就是一个中心。
I've spent the last 20 to 30 years collecting these scores, especially Chinese ancient scores that are found in other countries. And this year, we're building a database for those scores.
So, on 10月1号, our cultural center is open to the world.
And the website, the database, was launched actually on October 1st.
那么今天我今天主要是想讲讲有关中国的古朴，就东亚的古朴，这个古朴中心的一些事情。So
in today's lecture, I'm going to talk about the ancient scores of China and East Asia, and also about the research center and the database.
那么西方乐谱呢，出现大概在九世纪的时候，牛木谱就开始出现之前，中国就开始已经早在六世纪就出现了乐谱。
So Western music notation appeared around 9th century, but Chinese music notation appeared actually a little bit earlier, early in the 6th century. So the earliest notation we found was for the 古琴, the 7th string sitar.
然后八世纪以后，逐渐逐渐在中国出现琵琶、横笛、笙、筝、等等各种类型的乐谱出现。And
from the 8th century on, we've discovered music notation for the 古筝, the zither, the long zither, for the transverse flute, for the sheng, which is the mouth organ, and many other types of scores.
那么这些乐谱呢？ 随着就是当时一些遣唐使、遣隋使到了中国以后，日本这些当中有学习音乐的人，把这个乐谱带到了日本、朝鲜、 还有后来的乐乐曼四载，就是明代以后。那么这些乐谱呢，后来就代表了这些乐家。
So these scores, some of them are brought by Japanese ambassadors to China, to Japan, and they are also transmitted to countries like Vietnam around that same time.
那么中国这个乐谱呢，它是一种称为开口曲的奏法，不同的乐器不同的乐谱，跟西方不同。
So Chinese music ancient notation.It's a kind of tablature that describes the playing method, the playing manner of individual instruments, and this will be very different from Western notation at that time.
那么这些乐谱呢，随着中国的乐器变化，它的乐谱呢开始没有得到保存和传承。
And as Chinese instruments, ancient Chinese instruments evolved into different forms.The earlier forms of notation was lost and was not disappeared from view and from use.
比方说，中国八世纪的时候，琵琶它是横抱，拿着拨子这样来四弦四个下来演奏。
For example, in the 8th century, the pipa, the lute, is played by holding the instrument like this.Horizontally and then using a plectrum.
那么这些乐器，那么后来呢，中国的琵琶开始逐渐竖起来，把拨子扔掉，直接用手指，然后音韵加大。
So, as history progresses, the playing of pipa was transformed dramatically, in that a plectrum is no longer.
And the instrument is played only with fingers.
So, people of the later time periods, they could not read earlier notations from the Han dynasty, and they are lost.
那么日本呢，他拿着这个乐谱。这个乐器到了日本以后，这个一千年，有可能乐器没有发生变化，乐谱还照样在使。
A lot of the instruments and the music notation were preserved in Japan, and throughout the millennium, they remained the same.
所以呢，就是说，这个乐谱体系呢，从中国开始，整个到东亚，建立了完整的乐谱体系。
So the musical scores, all the way from China to other Asian, East Asian countries, together form a corpus or system of musical notations.
因为意思来说呢，中国它的乐谱没有继承以后呢，在东亚的朝鲜和日本
a lot of these musical scores are then preserved in Korea and Japan.
那么，中国在我们丝绸之路这一段来看，就是从汉朝到唐朝这一段的佛教的一些文库当中，我们可以看到非常丰富的乐舞表现。
According to historical.Archaeological findings in the Buddhist caves that were related to the span from the Han Dynasty to the Tang Dynasty, there were a lot of information we gathered regarding the musical scores.
那么随着中国进来，就是进入二十世纪八十年代以后，中国开始改革开放，中国的经济发达以后，对传统音乐的一种期待。是非常高的，就是希望就是把过去的音乐复原出来。
Since the reform and opening up in the 1980s, Chinese economy was in a boom, and there was an increasing need for finding historical music, historical.
那么这样呢，就是说，我们如何来恢复或者重新建设，就是过去古代的音乐成为在陈列装在近代史上是非常重要的事情。
So the revival and the reconstruction of historical ancient music, right now is a very important matter.
那么要重新建设过去的一些音乐的话，有两件事是比较重要，必须要做。
So in order to reconstruct ancient music, there are two major tasks that need to be done.
第一件事，首先我们把乐谱要找到，全部收集起来，要公布出进行研究。
So the first task is to collect all the ancient scores and analyze them.
第二件事情，我们必须要把过去的中国古代的乐器进行复原，把这些乐器复原以后，然后重新把过去的声音来做出来。
And the second task would be to reconstruct the instruments and try to reconstruct the sound of those instruments in order to perform on them.
那么现在上海音乐学院现在很重要的一件事情，先把古谱收集起来。那么进行研究是一个很重要的事情。
So what the research center in Shanghai is doing right now is to collect these ancient scores and to study and analyze them.
那么今天我首先想谈谈两个，一个就是说先把古谱的形态，中国有哪些古谱的形态，跟大家做一个介绍。
So we'll first in this lecture talk aboutthe forms, the different forms of ancient scores of China.
好，第一个就是说，我们首先，这是我们最早发现的一个古琴的一个古谱，这是古琴，这是在唐朝的古琴。这个琴呢，就是这是一个正面，这是一个反面。
So this is a 古琴, a zither from the Tang Dynasty, and this is the front and this is the back.
那么这里我们可以看到正面它有十三个 position 点，当中一点，然后各六点。
So we can see, sorry about that. So we can see here there are.13 points, 13 studs on there, and Professor Zhao calls them positions.
那么这个是，再说下面，前面，那么这个就是古琴的，我们把它称为归位，归位就是 position， 就是它的位置，这是一点，然后各六点。
The positions that we just talked about are called Hui in Chinese.
那么一共有七根弦。
There are seven strings.
这样一个琴弦。那么现在发现最早的是下面一个，下面一个。这个是我们现在发现最早的，就是调幽兰。幽兰谱前面有一个小序，乐谱从这里开始。
So this is the earliest ancient score using notation of China found called 节时调幽兰 and that part is a short introduction or preface to this notation and the actual notation itself starts there.
那么这个乐谱呢就是说从现在来看是六世纪乐谱就是秋明这个所传的这个乐谱的抄写年代是唐朝八世纪是唐朝抄写就是乐谱呢是一个就是抄写的人是八世纪的人但是这个乐谱呢原来存在是在就是六世纪就有
So from historical findings this score came from the 6th century but this particular document is transcribed in Tang Dynasty a bit later in the 8th century
那么从这个乐谱来看它是完全一共大概这个是中国的汉字一共是4950个字左右这样一个汉字那么完全是用来描述的比方说左手用第几指在第几规上滑到第几规右手用第几拳然后拍还是打还是说这样两句话形成一个音貌
there are about 4950 Chinese characters in this music notation And the way the notation works is that it uses two sentences to describe the way to play one pitch. For example, it describes in prose how you should, what position you should put your left hand finger on, and how you should use your right hand fingers to pluck what string, and this piece of each piece of description is only responsible for producing one pitch. So it is a highly complex music notation. So this is the very end of the document of the music notation. It shows a list of different music pieces. So there's a significant reform, revolution in music notation in Tang China, the reform was spearheaded by Chen Zhuo and Cao Rou.
那么简字，有先生的简字，那么简字呢，简就是减少的意思，字就是它保留的中国汉字的一个部分，形成这样一个情形。
So this new form of notation is called 简字谱, and 简 here means omit, and 字 means Chinese character.
好，这个呢就是整个就是现在后来唐朝改革以后的乐谱。 比方说这个字有四个部分左右，上面这个部分，这个是无名指，在第九徽上滑到，这是滑到第二弦，然后用钩这样一个音。So
this is an example of how the 简字谱 works. In the top left corner, there is the ring finger of the left hand, and the top right hand corner. Is 9, that means the 9th position. And bottom left corner is an indication of a musical technique of sliding your finger up to a different position. And the bottom right corner is indicating the technique of plucking the second string with one of the right hand fingers, and then this whole Chinese hybrid Chinese character makes one pitch.
那么这个呢大大简化了，原来用两句话形成一个音高，现在这就是一个这样一个汉字就形成一个音高。
So this is much more simplified compared to the prose notation of earlier times.
那么这个古琴谱。
The use of this 简字谱 notation has still continued even to today.
好，简字这个样，再上下一次。好，这个就最早的乐谱，我们翻译出来大概四五行谱，因为这个就是音阶排列。这样，这个现在好改成一个就是简字谱，就是这样。
So this is the score transcribed into Western notation. The top left hand corner shows the scale used in this piece of music.
这个是南宋的白石道人，那么其实呢，唐朝我们说是改革的简字，但我们没看到，真正最早看到就是这个南宋的，这里我们可以看到全是，就是古琴。
So this is from another music notation from the Southern Song Dynasty, and this again shows the 简字谱 notation. So this is the same piece, Gu Yuan, transcribed into Western notation.
好，那么除了古琴谱是中国文人所用的专门的一个乐谱，那么琵琶这个乐器呢，实际上它是从不是中国的原来乐器，它是从西亚传进来。西亚传进来以后呢，它有形成就三种，就是不同的乐器。那么这个最主要就是四弦琵琶，就是今天我们就是江苏用的，这个是一个就一组，它最早它的造型是这个样子。
So the guqin that we just talked about belonged to a class of Chinese literati of that time. And this second instrument is a little bit different. It's actually an imported instrument into China. And there are three main forms of the pipa. And we'll focus more on the first form, the four-stringed bent neck pipa.
那么这个琵琶现在是日本的一个博物馆，就销售的，就是正仓院的存在。这个是当时80几年的琵琶。
So this particular pipa is from the 8th century. Is now preserved in the Shosoin Museum of Japan.
那么这是一个四弦曲项琵琶。
This is a typical four-stringed bent neck pipa.
那么琵琶有三个种类。还有一种经过了就是西亚到了印度以后印度化的，从印度传到中国来的一个琵琶叫五弦直弦琵琶。
This second type of pipa is another form that traveled from West Asia into India and became Indianized actually, and it turned from four strings into five strings.
那么这个叫阮弦，这个阮弦是中国通过四弦琵琶跟中国的一个乐器叫弦陶，然后形成这样一个乐器。
So this instrument is a kind of a hybrid between a native Chinese instrument called the 弦陶 and the influence from the pipa from imported from the West.
那也就是说，从八世纪的唐朝来看。琵琶的种类有三类，就刚刚是一个四弦曲项琵琶、五弦直弦琵琶和一个管弦琵琶。
So, in the context of 8th century China, Tang China, there are these three main types of pipa.
所以这个几个琵琶现在都藏在正仓院。
And all these instruments shown here are preserved in the Shosoin of Japan.
好，那么琵琶呢，就是进入中国以后啊，这是进入中国的一个情况，做了一个交代，就是最早就是通过，就是这个冈德勒最早有一个叫巴布特，这个巴布特在冈德勒这个地方呢开始向着一个中国和印度，那么印度变成五弦直弦琵琶，然后呢四弦曲项琵琶也进入中国，五弦直弦琵琶也进入中国，这样一个情况。
So this shows the historical trajectory.Of the earliest pipas import into China. Basically, it originated from the Gandhara kingdom, which is modern-day Afghanistan and Pakistan. This earliest four-string form entered China first, and then a second form, which was first Indianized in India, also traveled to China, but at a later date.
那么这个进入20世纪以后呢，就是中国进入一个莫高窟，在莫高窟的第17窟，一个叫藏经洞里面，就是法国人叫格里奥，就是伯希格，他发现了这个经文当中后面有一个乐谱叫敦煌，后来被称为叫敦煌琵琶。
So in the early 20th century, there are findings of actually musical notation in the very famous Mogao cave.Of Dun Huan, China, and the finding was done by a French researcher of that time.
那么敦煌琵琶谱这个呢，在中国引起很大的轰动，因为当时它的发现呢是长兴四年，就933年。那么当时一直藏在中国，就说是它完整的一个中国的一个琵琶乐谱。
So this came as a huge shock and a surprise for many Chinese people of that time because. It is a score that was preserved right in China, and it's from as early as from the year of
933 CE.
So this set of musical notation includes 25 pieces of music separated into three groups. The first and second groups have 10 pieces each, and the third group has 5.
主要是根据他的就是书写的笔记不同，把它分成三群。
And these three groups are, these scores are grouped by their handwriting styles, the transcribing handwriting styles.
那么这个是经文，这个是最早正面的一个经文。乐谱呢是在经文的背面抄写的，现在藏在法国就是国家图书馆这边。
So, And for the Zhonghua Pipa score, the music notation is actually transcribed on the back of a Buddhist scripture, and this shows the scripture, and on the back of this document is the music notation. And this document is now preserved at the French the National Library in Paris.
好，那么这个呢，就是它就是 P 九配六，它是三八零八是最主要，二十五首都是在这里，一共有三份乐。那么其中这是最重要的。那么这个呢，我们可以看到这个写法一共是二十个谱字，然后呢正好应对就是四弦巨象琵琶的二十个空位。
So in this particular notation, it shows the 20 symbols, notational symbols used for the pipa, and they correspond to the positions of on the instrument, the four string pipa.
好，那么从整个琵琶谱这个系统来看呢，就是因为它是933年还是比较晚的，在日本常有比较早的乐谱，比方说像天彪饼琵琶谱，就是天平琵琶谱，藏在正仓院的，还有呢有福建宫本琵琶谱3516，这个是不同时期的这些乐谱。
Although the Zhonghua Pipa score is the earliest we can find in China, but there are other musical notation, earlier music notations found and preserved in Japan, including the Tenpyo Pipa score, the Fushimi Miyamoto Nangu Biwafu, and the Sango Yoroku. They are all preserved in Japan.
那么这个是琵琶谱的谱子，刚刚我们所看到的上面的谱子，把它拖下来，就是这个二十个谱子。
So these are the 20 pitch symbols used in the pipa score that we've just seen in that document.
那么五弦琵琶谱也有一份留着，但是五弦琵琶谱有27个谱子在这里。
And on music notations for the five-string pipa, there are actually 27 pitch symbols instead of 20.
那么前面二十个谱子完全可以对应跟四弦琵琶一模一样，但是后面一根弦就多一根弦，它一共有七个谱子。
So the first 20 pitch symbols for the five-string pipa are actually the same as that those for the four-string pipa, but since there is one more string on this pipa, it requires 7 more symbols added to that.
应该是525个谱子，那么这里就多出两个谱子，这个七个字里面有多出两个是相同的。
So, since it's 5 strings, it should be 25 pitch symbols, but in this case, there are 2 extra pitch symbols used.
那么现在我们可以对照一下，这个是日本仍然在使用的，就是四弦琵琶的谱子和它的柱位。这是 the first fret, second fret, third fret, 这样一共有25个谱子。
So this is the symbols that are actually still used in Japan right now. That shows the 20s. which symbols that correspond to the four strings of that pipa.
那么这个呢是 first string pipa， 两个谱子拨出来的呢，这个是中和口字呢被认为是一个谱子在这个位置上，还有一个谱子呢应该是在这个位置，因为是现在这一份五弦琵琶谱，根据这个五弦琵琶谱的排列，这个小字只能放在这个位置，尽管好像在理论上就实践上很不合理，但理论上只能放在这个位置上。
So, the two extra symbols that we found for the five-string pipa only make sense if they're put on that right-hand side at the third string, and the first string, just that midway between the open string and the second string on the fourth string.
它的排列是，这是一个大二度，小二度，小二度，小二度。
So the frets the first fret is a whole tone apart, second half tone apart, a semitone apart, and the third one semitone apart, and so on. So the 小, the one of the two extra symbols would be put there.
好，那么这个就是天平琵琶谱，就是这么一份。被抄写在经文背后的一个，就是在日本发现，在正仓院藏着。这个现在可以看是琵琶当中最早的一份琵琶谱，是747年。
So this is the Tianpiao Biwafu, the earliest extant notation for the pipa, preserved in Japan, and this is again transcribed on the back of a Buddhist scripture.
那么接下来就是说。五弦琵琶谱是一份就是非常完整的一份琵琶谱，藏在日本的京都的阳明文库，这是它的一个谱子，抄得非常干净。
So this is another music notational document preserved in the Yomei Bunko of Kyoto, and this what's unique about this is that this is very complete and very neatly transcribed.
这个是五弦琵琶谱的一个最前面地方的它的一个 program， 它的一个这个是六个调，调音乐调、大石调、黄钟调，以上这个是六个调子，后面全部是曲目。从这个曲目来看，全部是唐代的文献当中所出现的唐代的曲目，像《秦皇后正乐》啊，《天长曲》、《河南子》、《王昭君》。
So this is a kind of content page found on that five-string pipa score document, and it first shows the different modes used for the music. There are six modes, different modes. They're named properly, and the names here are names of music pieces arranged in those modes. And they are music pieces all from the Tang Dynasty.
再见。那么这个呢，就是838年的，就是福建公主的琵琶。
So this
is a pipa.
So this is another pipa score called the Miyamoto Nagubiwaku from the Tang Dynasty 838 CE.
现在藏在日本的宫内厅，就是宫内藏。
So this is preserved in the Japanese kunai cho.
那么这是三五幺路，三五幺路的谱子种类蛮多的。那么这个是公元4章，跟后面一个真谱叫任子幺路，都是在12世纪末叶完成的，就是那个乐谱，这个琵琶。
So this is the Sanko Yoroku is a set of many different kinds of music notation, music scores.And together with the Jinchi Yoroku that we'll show you later, they are both transcribed in the late 12th century.
好，再见。那么这个就三个，都是唐代的曲目。
So these are all Tang Dynasty music pieces recorded in the Sango Yoroku.
那么这个是横笛谱，就圆弓弓，这个也是侧柏桃李方，也是唐代的曲目。 那么当时这个比较稍微晚一点，九百六十六年。
So this is again a Tang Dynasty musical piece, but this is for the transverse bamboo flute, and this is of a later date in 966 CE.
好，下面。那么这个时间只要刚刚讲的就是也是开始上，它是一个真。
So this is the Jinji Yoku that we talked about in passing just now, transcribed by Fujiwara no Muranaka. And this is for the jung, the long zither.
那么从这个曲目来看，这个全是唐代的曲目，像《黄帝破阵宴》《团乱曲》《玉树后庭花》《春莺传》等等都是唐曲。
These are all again Tang Dynasty music pieces.
那么这个是声谱，就毛瑟。
This is a score for the mouth organ, the shang.
好，那么中国的乐谱呢，就是我这里就不举例了，有很多这个乐谱。那么从现在所发现的，就是说从《金石雕幽兰》到明代的三千多首，到明代以后就是突然出版三千多首乐谱，那么构成了中国庞大的就是古琴音乐的世界。此外，唐代以来呢，就又出现了就是新的乐谱，像琵琶谱、筝谱、横笛谱。那么这样呢，宋代后来又出现了蜀制谱、宫廷谱等等，形成中国一个庞大的一个乐谱体系。
So this is a mini wrap up of what we've just discussed. Earliest from the Jie Shi Diao Yu Lan, the earliest Qin score, to the 3,000 plus scores that are published in mainland China.
那么这些
and of course the many other music notations for other instruments found in Tang Dynasty and later dynasties, we have a huge corpus in music scores.
那么这些庞大的乐谱体系开始向东亚传播，日本、朝鲜或者越南都接受了中国这个乐谱体系。
So, these scores traveled to Korea, Japan, and Vietnam, and they formed a huge corpus of scores across East Asia.
那么这样的一个庞大的乐谱体系，这些乐谱呢，就是内容非常庞大，版本复杂，认识也是非常混乱。那么而且呢，大部绝大部分这些谱子全部流失到中国以外的地区，特别是日本。
And these scores, since they're dispersed far and wide in many different regions, our knowledge thereof is quite disorganized and confused.
So, 就是如何把这些乐谱收集起来，然后进行整理筛选、善本收集，尤其是将大量流失海外的乐谱集中起来，进行完整的、全面的数据库的储存，是一种非常重要的事情。
So it would be. So it would be very important and meaningful to comprehensively edit and organize these scores and establish a database for these scores.
那么这样呢，就建立一个非常公开的一个网站，让所有能够研究的人通过不同的研究，把这个时代的音乐能够展现出来，是一件非常重要的事情。
That is why we have established a website for researchers around the world.To gain access to these ancient musical scores.
那么上海音乐学院呢，就是通过常年几十年的积累和整理，把这些乐谱拿来以后，进行了版本处理，然后进行了解读，写出了一些就题解。那么这样以后呢，就建立了一个网站。
So the research center in Shanghai has spent the last several decades collecting these scores.Analyzing them and most importantly, annotating these documents for research purposes.
那么这样以后呢？现在到目前为止，我们已经收集了大概100多种古谱，然后呢，大概有 将近两万页左右的高清的就是扫描件。
So we've collected over 100 sets of different ancient notation, and we've had almost 20,000 pages of high resolution electronic copies of those documents.
那么将来逐渐我们进行还有乐器图，然后还有乐书这些收集到我们的中心来。
So in the near future, the next step in the project will be to collect illustrations of instruments, musical instruments, and musical writings.
那么在这些乐谱当中呢，有些是中国固有的乐器，比方像古琴。但是这些乐谱有很多乐谱是不是中国先就是传到外国去的这些乐谱，我们把它收集起来。那么还有一些中国传出去以后。由当地人自己在抄写，重新在继承发展，这些乐谱也在我们收集范围。
So we have collected scores that were for Chinese instruments that are preserved in foreign countries, but we've also collected scores that traveled to say Japan and edited and transcribed by the local scholars and scribes in Japan, and we have collected these scores as well.
从时间上来说，我们把它分成唐前、唐代，然后宋代，然后明清，不同的时期。
In terms of time periods, we have divided what we have into pre-Tang, Tang, Song.
那么这主要是流行于海外，中国没有的。那么其中的谱子的种类呢？除了刚刚讲的四弦、五弦这琵琶谱，然后筝谱、横笛谱、笙谱，还有琴歌谱、声乐谱。
So there are many different types of notations for the respective instruments, including qin scores, pipa scores.And for different types of pipa, of course, for the zheng, for the sheng, and for the transverse flute.
那么我们在这些乐谱的收集过程当中进行数据化的整理和储存，对这些乐谱最重要还要进行解读和它的认证，它是一个什么乐谱，什么材料组，一会儿我们会讲，就是一个非常复杂的认证。
So we not only collect.And analyze these scores, we also strive to annotate these scores and verify their versions.
那么，范博，今年就是十月份以后，我们网站成立了，这个就是我们的网站，就是中国与东亚古谱研究中心这样一个网站。这是唐前、唐代、宋代、明代、清代，然后现代。这是一份古琴，这是一个谱，就是一个样子。那么这里呢，就是一个解说。
So this is the website we've been waiting for, and they are neatly categorized by time periods. This is an example of a musical document, musical notation, and that piece of description is the annotation we've provided for this particular document.
那么这是一份明清谱，明清谱里面叫韦斯乐谱。
So this is a musical notation from Ming Dynasty. Called the Wei, the music notation of the Wei.
那么，这是我们刚刚讲最早的介绍调阅览，里面是非常详细的，包括它的分类、书名、读法等等这些内容的尺寸啊、材料等等这些。
So this example is the earliest 古琴 score that we discussed the 介绍调阅览。It shows here the name of the score, the material of the document, the time period, of course, page number, size, and all other related information.
那么这个关于这个古琴谱的它的来龙去脉在这里有解说，备注。
Oh, so this is a short description, a short introduction to the history of this.
那么这是另外一份乐谱，啊，这是介绍的，这是原谱，这是一个。 这个题型。
So this is the Jishudao Yonglan, the musical notation, and this is the image of the document here, shown here, and this is the annotation for that.
这个就是头语。
So this again shows the document, the top is the introduction and the beginning part of the notation itself, and this would be the catalog of musical pieces at the very end of the document.
好，这是另外一个乐谱，这是明清时期的一个乐谱，也相同，就是用这样一个。
So this is another example of music notation. This is actually from the Qing dynasty, and again, it shows all the relevant information for this document.
这是它的一个 program， 它这个从乐谱里面所含有的那么多的一个曲目。
This is actually the catalog, the content page for this particular Qing dynasty document. It shows all the musical pieces that are included in the and the source.
好，这个是它的一个乐谱的一个原件。
So this is an electronic copy, a photocopy of the document, the original document.
这个是原件。
And then there's another section of that document.
好，那么这个呢，就是在就是我们今年十月一号就公开，就是向大家展出了。那么这个呢，就是我们收集的一个乐谱的一个情况。
那么这个乐谱情况数字化以后呢，就是说我们首先呢，就是感到这个乐谱呢，就是说为大家提供了一种比较就是优质、准确、安全的，就是研究文本。那么，希望这项基础研究对我国的就是古代音乐历史的研究作为文献呢，做出一种贡献。
So this website database was launched probably the previous month or earlier, and it's open for access to everyone and. We seek to provide researchers with high quality, accurate, and safe research materials, and it's our hope that this will benefit the study of historical music in China.
那么我们的网站呢，就是主要是古代乐谱的收集、整理和数据化的储存、体检等这些工作呢，是一件非常繁重、艰难的工作，花费了大量的时间和精力。
So the project of collecting these scores, digitizing them, and annotating them has been an arduous task, and it requires huge investments of time and energy.
当然，这项工作呢，就是受到海内外很多就学术机构以及专家学者对我们的大力支持和帮助。
But of course, this project has benefited from all the different. Researchers from different institutions from around the world.
那么这项基础资料的一个基础性的一个史学工作呢，在全国开放了，无疑对我国的一个以及东亚的一些古代音乐的研究呢，提供了一个非常重要的一个时代的资源。
We believe that the publicization of these historical documents would be an invaluable resource.For the study of Chinese and East Asian historical musics.
那么这些流失于海外的古代乐谱呢，回归到中国呢，将对我国古代音乐史的重新认识、真正的构筑，就是古代音乐的音响实践呢，提供一个重要的一个基盘。
And the collection of these scores from all around East Asia would be an important step in actually reconstructing. Ancient music.
那么是为了使网站的一个质量和规模呢更具有实力，那么在此呢，我们也欢迎就持有相关针对古谱与我们就是这样的一些学者与我们取得联系，以便呢就是能够更加丰富和加强我们的数据库，让我们齐心协力共同努力啊，把中国古代音乐史的基础工作。
So we welcome contacts from private owners and any persons that possess these precious ancient stores, and we hope that your contribution would be able to improve and enrich our database for the purpose of research, and let's gather our efforts in the study of ancient music in China.
谢谢大家。